Independent. In-depth.
Inside EWN on 702.
Live.
Online.
The 702 app and DSTV.
You're still tuned into Inside EWN. It's just gone 6 minutes past eight. So, it's time for the roundtable, but I want to be able to explain my thoughts as we get into it. So, if you take the time, and I really think you need a lot of time to read the already published parts of the state capture report, I assure you, you will leave with many, many, and I mean like a lot of things swirling in your head. You'll leave with many thoughts in your head, like this maybe.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I keep on. That's what I want. 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 That's what I want.
Yes, money. Yeah, I thought about money a lot going through the state capture report. I thought money, money, money. Then I thought, yes, this project was so incredibly intricate. Then I kept thinking, yes, I'm not surprised to see particular names being implicated in particular ways. However, what also caught me off guard is the lengths that they would go to, the extremes that they would go to. And I also kept thinking, how easy is it for these people, the elite, people handed public power, people entrusted with making decisions that make sure that we are well looked after, that the country keeps ticking, that things that need to be taken care of in the country are done, how easy it was for them to gamble with that responsibility. And then I kept going back to the money, the sums. How much money was being moved around, toyed around with? When you look at the reports, yeah, 7 billion here, 2.2 in 1 year. The amount of money from these contracts that were not authorized, these illegal contracts, it's actually quite disgusting. And it's part of the conversation I wanted to have. I brought in three guests to try and help me unpack this phenomenon where power and money intersect, where the belief that absolute power corrupts absolutely continues to ring true. The guests who are joining me for this conversation include Mosilo, who is the former CEO of Trillian, turned author, her tell-all book, A Diary of a Whistleblower and Courageous Fight Against the State Capture, and captured the true account of the Nene Gate Trillian whistleblower. So Mosilo is going to be with us. We've got Dr. Saths, who's a clinical psychologist and a struggle veteran, because some of the people who are doing these things are his comrades. It'll be interesting to see what he thinks and what he understands, and also to unpack what happens in the mind of somebody where they rationalize and go, yeah, this is what I will do. It's perfectly fine for me to assist somebody to steal. Then I also have my colleague Teto Matlakwana, Eyewitness News senior political journalist. Teto actually kind of started this conversation as she was going through the Transnet chapter of the report, and she was like, the amount of money that was being played around with. But I also want to hear your thoughts. What is your price? Is there an asking price? What happens to you? What happens to your morals? Or is the question of what are morals anyway? What happens when you are given so much responsibility? Think about Melusi Gigaba. To me, Melusi Gigaba feels like Icarus. Too close to the sun, waxed wings, whichever way you want to look at it. Melusi Gigaba, everybody talks about how this man was destined for presidency. He was meant to lead. He gambled with it. Now he's persona non grata. Think about Brian Molefe. The amount of anxieties you'd get, how you suit up and set yourself straight to meet this doyen of black excellence, Brian Molefe, and how today you speak about him crying at the Gupta Shabin, and then you speak about how he's a Gupta lackey. How did these people allow themselves to become this? What happens? What happens to someone's mindset? That's the conversation we are having tonight. I want your contributions. I want to know, one, what is your asking price? What are you worth? What makes you turn on your own morals? Two, what is the sickness and how do we get rid of it from our society? Because we sit and we say, oh, corruption is an endemic in South Africa. But how do we rid ourselves of this one attachment? And I ask this because we are so quick to put out a 20-rand note to get rid of a fine. So what does it entail? What is needed in order to get there? You can reach us on 011-883-0702 if you're in Joburg. In Cape Town, that number is 021-446-0567. You can SMS, that line is 31702. You can also WhatsApp, leave a voice note on 072-702-1702. I definitely want your views. Again, what makes one susceptible to corruption? The powerful specifically. That's who I'm looking it. Teta, I want to start with you. Hi, Teta, welcome. I want to start with you. And I want to say to you, I picked up money as an issue. You picked up money. But that wasn't the only thing that you pick up when you read the reports, Teto. You also then sit and go, yo, it was so important to get rid of particular people and make sure that you've got the right people in the right positions to make sure things happen.
Good evening, Pidi. I mean, that's like one of the most intricate parts of that particular report, right? Because one is like so fascinated as to the machination of it all. What exactly did it take for Transnet to become the hotbed of corruption and state capture in the country, as the Zondo Commission found? And when you go through the processes, you realize that actually, it didn't take rocket science. You are just like, no, just three guys, of course, powered by the political force and muscle of the time, in the form of former Minister Malusi Gigaba and former President Jacob Zuma. Of course, you know, I think it's very important to listeners that these are allegations as far as the fact that no one has been tested in the court of law. So you have then Brian Mulete, who is then the CEO. You have Anuj Singh, who is the chief financial officer. And you have Siyabonga Gama, who is responsible for one of the most profitable units in Transnet. And between the three of them, they come up with a scheme, right? And by the time they even come up with the scheme, you have Salim Essa on the other side, who is the Gupta lieutenant. And I think in South African everyday speak, they would say he's the ice boy. And he set up this account, and shelf account of it, and they're ready to process and launder the money that would then be the product of that, you know, racketeering enterprise, as the commission calls it. Because by the time they come up with this mission to have 300 billion rand of transit money invested in infrastructure, and on the face value, you are like, okay, actually, I understand. We need to move the trucks off the roads so that we preserve the lifespan of the roads and the tar, and we need to move, you know, goods and every other, you know, economic movement onto rail. And they're like, we need new locomotives. And then, literally, that was the spark. And even in the formulation of that particular strategy, the aim, when you read the report, was nothing else but corruption. So I've been asking one question the whole week. How is it that it was that methodological, yet no one else outside of that enterprise saw the warning signs and could warn us to say this is about
this is what's happening. I actually want to then bring in Mosilo Mothepu, because she's a whistleblower. These are the people who saw what was happening. Mosilo, you worked for regiments and worked for Trillian. How intricate, first of all, was this project? What work went into amassing so much wealth? Teto says something very interesting there, where like, we didn't have people warning us until a particular set of people started coming out. Of course, you are one of them, to say, listen, something is not okay here. How intricate is this project?
Okay, I'm going to be all protocol observed kind of person.
Okay.
What is his name? Who are on my panel? So that I can understand who I'm speaking to.
Okay,
I'm Mosilo Mothepu.
Mosilo, you're speaking to CD Madia, who's hosting you on 702.
I am Mosilo Mothepu, author of Encaptured, former CEO of Trillian Financial Advisor and Regiment principal. And then you are?
I'm the person who's hosting you, Mosilo. My name is CD Madia. Okay?
Yeah.
And then you're joined by Dr. Saths Cooper.
Yeah.
And Teto Matlakwana.
Okay.
Now, good evening. Now, Teto just spoke about what she saw in the report as far as Transnet was concerned, and how intricate the network was, yet we didn't have warnings. People didn't warn us as to what they're seeing. And I'm saying, Mosilo, you're a whistleblower. You are one of those people who said something is not okay. And my question to you at the moment is, how intricate was this project?
I thank you so much, Sidi, for this opportunity. I'm not a whistleblower. I'm a patriot. I'm a warrior. I'm a soldier. I was willing to die for this democracy. I hate that term, whistleblower. I'm an accountant. I got a 75% up a second, and I did a corporate finance and investment at this. I'm a patriot. And we have to start. South Africa needs to, number one. This whistleblower, it's like we're gambling. I don't know how much time we have.
I don't have that much time. I do want to come back to the issue around how you are treated, Mosilo, that I understand.
You're a patriot who said not in my name.
You're a patriot who said not in your name, Mosilo, come back to the conversation. Mosilo.
Yes.
I need you to come back to the conversation. I'll come back to the issue that you're raising. Let's stand where you are, where you are a patriot at the moment, and you took a stand. Help us understand what you were seeing. How intricate was what you were seeing in terms of the project to amass so much wealth?
Thank you. I was in the board. I was reported to sign irrational, invalid, unlawful contracts. And I knew, people call me the Nanagate whistleblower, because I knew that Nana was going to be fired in October and was fired in December. And I knew in March that Pravin was going to be fired because he was not signing the Putin R1 trillion nuclear deal, and he didn't sign the DDME Airbus deal. I saw Eskom, Transnet, SA Express, SAA, all of them paying Trillian and Eskom, and regiments without a valid contract, or they will call them confinement. Trillian. Do you know that 72% of the money that was siphoned off was taken from Transnet in terms of kickbacks? And regiment, a business development partner was Coben Moodley, who is now out on bail for fraud, theft, and corruption, and money laundering of $380,000, and his bail is $250,000. He arrested him at the airport. He was on the way to Dubai.
Just hold on, Mosilo. I think you've got hiccups. Just check for a second. You've got hiccups. I want to move on while I wait for Mosilo to make a glass of water. She's got hiccups. Dr. Sass, I want to bring you into the conversation. Doctor, it's crass. What we are seeing is crass. It's brazen. It's shameful how public money was stolen. I have to ask you, what makes one do such? But for you, there's that other aspect where these are some of your comrades. Some of these are people you've known for years. When you see what's happening, how do you rationalize, or how do you understand the rationalization that is happening amongst these people when they're playing around with so much money and that responsibility I kept speaking about earlier, public power?
So I want to immediately say that all the people who have been outed and exposed over time have been comrades, yes, but from a very distant relationship. The people I have known would be morally upright, they would be committed, they would be principled, and they were truly courageous in the quest for social justice and the attempt to create a society that was better than that which we experienced. So, Matilo, when she says, I'm a patriot, that patriotism is not what many of these persons are made of. They have been, unfortunately, because we have had so many mistakes in our transition from apartheid to democracy, because of that, they have taken advantage of a situation, and we should also acknowledge that the definition of a politician is a person who is professionally involved in politics, especially as a holder of an elected office. But it also means a person who acts in a manipulative and devious way, typically to gain advancement within an organization and within the polity. Now, we have a crop of people, and they have been manipulating their organization, which unfortunately has been the majority party since the dawn of democracy. They have manipulated that and in turn wheedled themselves into public office and power. We have a system in our country which does not hold the individual accountable, because if we did in the common law, and right now, and I know that the NPA director has said why it takes so long. But there's common crime, there's common fraud, there's clear, egregious, unlawful acts which ought to be prosecuted. And if we can still get, if we can still get the representative of the presidency acknowledging in parliament last week that nothing has happened to the billions of rand that were taken during PPE. By the way, the SIU found 91.4% of all the contracts that they looked at to be irregular. That's 91.4. It should shock us, because we have over time become accustomed to wrongdoing. And somehow there has developed a system of patronage that, you know, the media has been part of, all sections of society has been part of, because we have denied wrongfulness. It's somehow somebody else who's wrong, or in another party, or of another persuasion than my party and myself. And that is the biggest problem we confront with the ANC being in power for this long, because very few of them stood up. The persons who did stand up find themselves outside of the ANC. And even now with the PPE scandal, it's as if Zuma was corrupt, but the rest are not. We have a bunch of politicians who are self-serving. They will use any trick in the book to justify their own actions, and none of them acknowledges blame. Not one of them has stood up and said, I am at fault and I will gladly subject myself to the rule of law. President Zuma has claimed that, but he's done everything to run away from his day in court. So that kind of entitlement, that kind of hubris, that kind of arrogance allows people to be close to power and then feel that they are the ones who are entitled to some of these, the largest that's in our country. And they have single-handedly, as a group of charlatans, brought our country to this pass now, because this country is a rich one. We have beggared our people. We don't need to have the levels of poverty we have in our country right now, the most unequal in the world, all because of politicians acting badly, acting for themselves and their buddies. And in that mix is a large part of the private sector who have been part of this agreement, if you like. I do something for you, you do something for me, and at the expense of the majority of our citizens. And that's why we are in this pass. We don't have upright, morally committed persons to do for our society what they should do. And to cover that, we have a proportional representation system, so nobody is held responsible. Even the city councillors who are elected, while we have half of them elected on a constituency basis, they also fall into this trap because they see this wealth and they see how it's been done. They learned very well from their apartheid masters and are doing it as an action now that is almost second nature to them. I'm going to pause there for you to interrogate them.
All right.
Whatever.
You said quite a mouthful. Teto, there's something that that Dr. Seth speaks about that feels like we're at a point where we can't shake it off. It feels like we are at a point of no return. It feels so deep-seated. We've got state capture. Now he's speaking about the PPE corruption. What does that mean? When you do a quick analysis of who and what we are, does it mean that we all have a price and are just waiting quietly for the opportunity to also steal?
Yeah, so the reality of it is this, that I'm going to give you an example before I come to Dr. Seth's remarks particularly. Mm. So you had a transfer, for example, the former treasurer, Matane Mahato, who came to the state capture inquiry and literally broke down because of what she had witnessed happen to this state-owned company. She alone, and I say alone because by the time that she intervened, the system had already been overtaken by the racketeering enterprise. And she stood in the way of a 750 million rand transaction going ahead without following the right procedures. And this is when, of course, they wanted to overtake the process and give out a loan that was meant for JP Morgan to regiments, rather, that cost billions of rand. And you have that kind of a leader. Then you turn around and you have the man who replaces him, which is then Ramutsibudi, rather, who took over from Mahato, and Mahato was then permanently sidelined because she quit. She quit in protest of the kind of lawlessness that was going on. Ramutsibudi then comes in and negotiates a 12 billion rand, takeover loan from JP Morgan to Trillian. JP Morgan, of course, you know that is a reputable accounting firm that has been around for decades and centuries, actually. So you Trillian, we know now that is a pawn of the racketeering enterprise.
Sure, sure.
And all that Ramutsibudi One City is a Range Rover Sport that does not even cost 2 million rand. And again, what is your price? So you are willing to see about 12 billion rand in the Zad Club go to a company that you know is nothing else but a front of a corrupt, establishment, all in exchange for nothing else but a Range Rover Sport. So it boggles the mind. And again, that's why this question kept haunting me, to say, but what then is your price when people are willing to give up their livelihoods? You saw Mahato being ostracized and literally haunted out of Transnet for trying to do what she has sworn to do as an accounting officer. Yes, you have people on the other side who are just like, I will negotiate a multi-billion rand deal for you that I know you are not worthy of, and I know you will not even lift a finger in doing the work for nothing but like little millions of rand. So it's literally a reflection, I think, leading on to what Dr. Sescupa said, that it's a reflection of us as a society, is a reflection of our interaction with wealth and riches and our interaction with money. And the fact that you have, I'm going to bring in a spanner, and we had, of course, tried to get a lot more of this particular conversation going on to say, there's also the body politic element of it. I've spoken to analysts in the week and academics who have said to me that, Teto, but if you look at the body politic that is South Africa, state capture is nothing but literally like a dent in the level of corruption that goes on here. Because you look at far back as the 90s when we had the arms deal. Has anything else come out of the arms deal other than someone going to jail for having been bought an ML? We still have, from a president, Jacob Zuma, you know, frustrating the justice system
Absolutely.
To account for that. But we also know, all of us know, it was not just him alone, you know? Mm. And we are not trying to pander into the particular narrative from that particular camp. But the fact is, corruption takes a lot of levers and layers. And it could not have just been the two, three people who have been seen hauled before the law who were participants in that particular enterprise. So then it begs the question, why would anyone else stop? And that's why the PPE is here. Why would you stop when you realize that actually the chances of getting away with it are higher than me being held accountable for it?
And that's the thing. That's the thing. Chances of getting away with it are higher than being held to account. Dr. Saths, it goes back to the issue of, and you spoke about already, just the lack of political will, I suppose, in dealing with these things. I don't know if it's because they're the same. I think, did you call them treacherous people in charge? I don't know if it's because they're the same people who are in charge, and dealing with the one must mean that, you know, the tables will be turned on you. For instance, with former President Jacob Zuma having gone to jail for however short a period, the conversations around political circles already are, well, we've set a precedent that a former president must go to jail. Cyril Ramaphosa must prepare himself to also go the same route. But what does it take for society to turn the page? Because those with political access to political power, that's how they rationalize things, and that's how they continue preventing themselves even from confronting certain issues, I suppose. So what do you then do when you're outsiders? South Africans, we get outraged on social media. We have pockets of outrage, but really, for the most part, are comfortable. What happened, what came out from the SIU as appearance in Parliament, we weren't bothered. What must happen to that society that breeds that kind of mindset, those kind of leaders, and that kind of action?
Well, look, I think dealing with the last part of what you raised, I think that for the most part, we have become attitudinalized to wrongdoing. And this has a long history. As you said, we've become comfortable with some of these things. So tomorrow, if crook X or fraudster Y, robber Z, were to offer us a few, flash a few notes at us, we will shut up. That's the terrible state to which we've been brought in our country, because all around us, that betrayal has resulted in betrayal by political leadership, by the way. Let's be very clear about
it. Yes, let's be honest. It is them.
Yeah. That betrayal has resulted in almost a lionizing of ill-requited wealth. You know, name me any serious politician who is just comfortable but not stinkingly wealthy and, flashing around. Now, apartheid, we need to appreciate, created a set of responses in us. If you look at the bell-shaped curve, there's a small number who joined and were part of that system. And on the other end, there was a small number who diametrically opposed that system. The rest of us fell somewhere in between. So we learned to live with it. And I know for a fact that if I went to a store in downtown Johannesburg in 1983, 84, I would walk in with somebody from, say, Soweto, and we'd walk in, look at a pair of sneakers, and instead of me paying, they would say, no, don't pay. And that evening or the next evening, you got that same pair of sneakers, which would have gone for about 500 Rand at 200 Rand. We see the same with our traffic officers. We see the same with our police. We see the same with people in power. If you were to get a tender, there is an assumption that you've gotten it crookedly, and that somebody somewhere, a bureaucrat or a politician, was going to get something out of it. Fast forward to the Eskom and Transnet debacle, breaking down institutions that actually were functioning and for the beneficiation of all people, we find that people getting there look at a tender. If it costs $1 million, it costs me as a businessman $1 million. You are the person who's the go-between, or you are on the other side. And you say, well, look, you can get it, but it will cost you 10% or even more. So I'm forced to put up the price to accommodate that. And the state pays. The state pays for what you can buy at Pick and Pay. They pay at least so many percent more. And the rationale given is because they buy in bulk. Actually, the rationale should be they're the biggest procurer and they should be getting it at a discount. But all of those arguments have been proven to be fake arguments for the benefit of a few at the top. So when you talk of factions, the factions out there are about stealing, about robbing the fiscus, about robbing from the poor. I mean, for crying out loud, in 2020, people stole food parcels
for
the really needy. They continue doing this in our schools where feeding schemes are supposed to be for our kids. When will it stop? We've got irredeemable political rascals, and they need to be outed. And look, in July, what happened where people...
The unrest.
The mayhem that was created there. People used that and other things started happening. You see it all around us. We live in a state of terrible uncertainty. There's threat upon threat. If I were to name you, you're going to say, but in the Amaz, where you were sat on in that period, you are a Naskari, you did this, you did that, or you sold out, etc., etc. But why shut your mouths for over 3 decades? Right? They shut their mouths, and it's only now that evidence is coming. Well, not even evidence. People are talking about it in chat groups. No, we need a change. It's not going to come. You know, the problem doesn't solve itself, and we are heading for rebellion. We're heading for wide-scale civil unrest, and we see it happening all around. It's just that the smart people have not joined the dots to create a force to overthrow this country, the rulers who have taken advantage of ordinary people's goodwill.
I want to come back to you, Dr. Cooper, not just about overthrowing these people who are doing a disservice to the country, but I want to come back to you and speak to you about, a little bit about those PPEs. You spoke about the PPEs and what was happening in 2020. I would like to come back. But before that, I want to put a call out to you again. You are more than welcome to participate in the conversation. Our number is 011-883-0702, 021-446-0567. Would you do it? What is your price? If you come into extreme power, you're given public responsibility, you rise on this assumption that you're going to be of service to the people, and suddenly there are people who are trying to influence you otherwise. When you think about the role of Melusi Gigaba, if you look at the report, the state capture report, it speaks about how he used his position to influence Lynn Brown. They use positions of power to get influence in order for this project to go ahead. What is your price? What is your thinking? How do you think they rationalize what they've done to the country? And of course, all of these arresting on allegations, I think it's one of the things that Teto said earlier, nothing has been proven as yet. We are still waiting, we are still praying for convictions around what we understand to have been done to the country. I want to at the moment bring in Parmi Natesan, who is the CEO of the Institute of Directors in South Africa. I want to bring Parmi into this conversation. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good evening, TD.
I want to speak about those who were not necessarily tied to the Guptas, those that you can't necessarily call lieutenants, but their behavior was enabling. And of course, what brings this conversation, with this part of the, into the conversation is Minister Ntshavheni, Khumbudzo Ntshavheni, was a board member. And one would say that she failed in doing her fiduciary duties and making sure that you are fully aware of what it is that you're being asked of, what you're fully agreeing to in that particular moment. And I want to just maybe get your thoughts around those kind of people and what their role was in enabling state capture, even if it was indirectly so.
I think what's clear from various reports that we've had, whether it be the Zondo report or even the SIU report mentioned earlier, is that there are directors and executives in both the public and private sector that played a role in enabling these corrupt activities. It couldn't have happened without these people, either one, not understanding what their role is, or two, understanding what their role is and choosing not to fulfill it adequately. I mean, being a director is a very serious responsibility, and there are legal duties when you take on this role. You have to act in the best interest of the organization. You have to act with good faith, with care, skill, and diligence. And if you don't understand what it means and what these legal duties are, then you almost shouldn't accept this position.
Should we see it as a celebration that the Zondo Commission goes beyond the architectures of state capture? The fact that we are able to zone in on board members. Very often we haven't been able to do that. That's why I think the Dudumieni issue in and of itself, being declared a delinquent director, is an important chapter in our country's history. Should we be seeing a lot more of those people being declared delinquents, I suppose? Should we celebrate the fact that we're being asked to go further to see all the nooks and crannies, really, that allowed for this project to take place?
Look, I think transparency is always a good thing. I mean, reading through the over a thousand pages, now if you include part one and part two of the state capture report, it's actually shocking the depth and breadth of these activities and how much unethical behavior was carrying on. And I think whilst it's not great to read it as a public because we just shocked at the level of unethical behavior, at the same time, if this behavior is carrying on, it's good that we now know, because that's the only way we can fix things going forward.
What are the possible fixes? What do we then do to try and tighten the loopholes and make sure that we don't find ourselves back here?
So there's a couple of things. Firstly, I think there needs to be consequences in people who were implicated in these reports. I mean, every time I read a new report, there's another 50-odd names of people being implicated, but we haven't yet seen any real consequences for those individuals, right? So I think that needs to happen. Then I think in terms of board positions itself, there's two things. The one is people need to be appointed to boards because they have the knowledge, skill, and expertise to fulfill that responsibility. And they also have the moral compass to act in the best interest of the organization and not in their personal interest. Secondly is the appointment process, which is a big problem. And we've been saying this for many years. I mean, normally you should have a proper process. You should have a detailed due diligence being conducted before people are appointed. You also need to look at who's making these appointments. If we have a single individual, being a minister, who's a politically involved individual, making an appointment to the board, they then need to be able to be transparently tell us as the public what criteria they use to choose these people, what due diligence they followed. Because unfortunately, to us, it looks like it's all political appointments and nobody's even looking at what skills and experience these people have to serve as directors.
All right. I'm going to leave it at that with you. Thank you so much, Parmi Natesan, CEO of the Institute of Directors in South Africa. Just speaking about what the expectations are and what the way forward is and trying to navigate this particular space. I'm going to take a quick break, but before that, you can call in, you can weigh in, you can maybe share what you think is the psyche that leads our leaders towards falling into these traps. Again, Melusi Kikaba, destined to be president. You have a lot of influencers, some did it for a car, who assisted in this process. What do you think is the rationale? Why are people doing this? And what do you do to turn it over? And what is your prize? Do you think that you are not above, you know, you can't be above the fray? That if you are also placed in that situation, you'll also have a prize. You'll have a cheap prize. Please call us. Our number is 011-883-0702 or 021-446-0567. You can text us on 31702. You can WhatsApp or leave a voice note. That number is 072-702-1702.
They find the news.
They read the bulletins. Now they take you inside EWN
on 702.
You are still tuned into Inside EWN on Talk Radio 702. I've been speaking to people about What makes the powerful susceptible to corruption? Why is it so easy when you have such a high post, assumably earning so much money? I think about Anuj Singh. I think Anuj Singh did not touch, he's not obviously public office, but he did not touch, I think, 19 million of his salary because he didn't need to live off of his monies. He was busy in the state capture project, living off of that. What makes one... What gives you into that life? What makes it so easy? Earlier, I've got different guests. I've got Teto Matlakwana, my colleague at EWN. I've got Dr. Saths Cooper still with me. I think we've lost Mosilo, who was the former CEO at Trillian, who doesn't want to be known as a whistleblower, but she is actually one of them. I do know that Mosilo is having a tough time. I think it's a difficult space that they're in, where they've taken a step against people that they've worked with to expose what is going on in the name, and as she said it, in the name of being patriots in this country, to say, whoa, something is happening. Something is happening with public monies. There are tenders going through that are not been, there are contracts rather going through that have not been put to tender. Something awful is happening. Dr. Saths, you spoke about earlier, you spoke about the PPE corruption and how these people were helping themselves to food parcels. And every time PPEs come up, I think about the president. And I think about how I actually was a journalist who said to President Cyril Ramaphosa, but what about corruption? You are sending billions to municipalities. We have a problem with corruption in our country. And the president stood there and confidently said, we've put measures in place. There will be no such. Only for me again to find the president a year later to say, so what did I say to you about corruption and what happened and what did you say versus what happened in your country on your watch? What do we then do, you know, with a leader like that?
You know, I mean, one of the most low points for me was when he, in answer to Chair Zondo's question about you were there, you were the deputy president. Indeed, Brian Molefe says, and everyone knows, he was the head of the so-called war room in ESCOM. When his response was a sheepish, I was afraid I would be fired or I would lose my job. Now, this is the sitting president. He was there at the relevant times as the second in charge, and he was afraid of losing his job, and he's reputed to be a multi-billionaire. Now, it tells you how deep the rot has sunk, because surely somebody like him should have stood up and said, I'm not going to go to Inkandla and say this fire pool is a fire pool, and make all sorts of excuses for the chief or the boss, who now gets excoriated as if he chose himself. You know, so there's a set of things that have happened. There's always been, you see, in the liberation struggle, we closed ranks. And when you were underground, when you were in exile, your life was tenuous because the apartheid system infiltrated all organizations from top to bottom. And you did not know whether you're going to see the next day or not. So I fully appreciate that closing of ranks. However, if one of us broke a cardinal oath in struggle, we would have dealt with him. How come in a democracy we extend a liberatory blanket of denial of protection, and it says that there's something very, very seriously wrong with our politics, and noting that every single one of them swears an oath of office, swears to uphold whatever constitution, which means nothing, and now they easily can trash a document. You see, a document, a constitution, does not make it your democracy. It is people who are in that democracy who create the democracy. And it is shameful that the public entities that are mandated by legislation to charge, to bring these scoundrels to book, have not done so. It's civil society organizations, like in the Dudunyeni matter. Civil society organizations have stepped in. Thank heaven we have still a robust civil society, but all around us in the Twitterati and other social media space, we seem to be canceling all these organizations out of sight, out of mind, in order to reduce their efficacy. So ordinary people are beginning to stand up, and we've seen that, Cindy. We've seen that from 96, 97. We saw that in the Free State, when Thabo Mbeki then banished both Lekota and Ace Magashule to Parliament and appointed the woman he did, Mothepu, to be premier. Now, we saw all those signs. And in the Zuma period, people took full advantage. But also, don't underestimate the fact that in the Gupta specific brand of capturing a segment of the leadership of our country, as well as the party, majority party, as well as different arms of the state, they were enabled by people who were not close to Zuma. Those persons were there before Zuma, and that's why he can say and he can refer to the kinds of luncheons. I don't know what kind of magic food the Guptas provided at Saxon World, but it sounds like
they still had a lot of traffic, you know, yeah.
Absolutely. And we even had the terrible video we've seen of late President Mandela praising that family. We've seen previous President Mbeki praising the mother of the three scoundrels, and so on. So it is, it's almost as if it is in the struggle DNA to do these kinds of things, to swear an oath and then do precisely everything to bastardize that oath. Thank heaven we have a vibrant media that every now and then shows it can stand up for itself. Thank heaven we have the Temba Masekos, the Mosilo,
the resistors of state capture,
did the right thing, and stood for justice. They were not supine collaborators. So I think that at a certain level, when you're choosing people, there needs to be character assessment. Is this person a fraud? Is this person susceptible to being hoodwinked? Is this person a person of integrity?
Mm-hmm.
Or is she or he going to end up being a crony and going to wither in the face of the chief or whoever? Number one says this, or number three, sure, or number two, or whatever. You know, and organized business needs to take account. If we had KPMG, if we had these firms, if we had these business consulting entities, they're worldwide, transnational entities. If we've had banks that were part of this, it tells us that the rot went deep. It takes two to tango.
To tango, it does.
In this case,
it does.
The corruptor and the corruptee.
It does. Hold on for a second there, Dr. Cooper. Teto, I want to bring you into the conversation because there's something that he does. He spoke about a lot of things that I actually want to pick at. And in part, I want to speak about labor's role and speak about civil society and whether or not, when you look at the landscape, do we have groupings that are still able to organize and have proper solid mass mobilization to say something? That's the one thing I'd like you to to comment on. But also, that's the issue of political will, where we're still talking about these people. They're still out there. If really what they did was understood to be a travesty to this country, if really what they did should not have been done to us at all, because we don't deserve it, because we're patriots, because we love our country, one imagines a government that wants to clamp down on anything along those lines. Yet, it's lagging. Even the international treaty, everything is just really slow when it comes to progress of trying to bring people back to be answerable for what happened in this country over however many years ago. Just your quick assessment on those two things. I am running out of time, so you can also just wrap your thoughts up for me, please.
So, Sidi, a couple of fundamental things about the nature of corruption, right? And it doesn't matter what kind of society you exist in, whether you are in an aristocratic society, you know, oligarchy, whatever else, that there is corruption, because corruption is tied to the human state of being. And that is because there will always be those in our society who believe that they are smarter, they are more knowledgeable, and they can cheat the system. And that has been so since the beginning of time. But what we do know about our reality is that we also have a very, very tragic situation where you have people who do not have careers until they become politicians, where they cannot amass any form of wealth independently until they have the level of power that is, you know, garnered through political office. And once that power is then attained, the most urgent thing to do is to ensure that you amass as much wealth as you can for yourself and your connections, so that in the 5-year term that you are done, or 10-year term that you are done, you are sorted for life. And that is, of course, quite tragic. But at the same time, the fact that we do not have a very, very proactive labor movement, and actually our labor movement is as much as division that came as a result of the compromises they made leading up to the 2007 ANC conference in Polokwane. Of course, there's a conversation for another day. Civil society is also not trusted, because a lot of them cannot even come on the table to me and tell you and I who their funders are, and there'll always be that mistrust, especially in a society that has suffered so much from apartheid and the many tentacles that it had, having been sponsored a lot by private companies that existed in our midst. So there's a mistrust, and there's also the fact that there's this human nature phenomenon that, of course, can only be sorted by appropriate law enforcement responses, and we do not have that. So until we do have that, the likelihood is, as you and I speak today, that capture is happening and continuing, and we are going to come back again after 10 years and say 9 weeks.
On that devastating note, let me leave it with you for a little while. And I think that's the problem. Dr. Saths, I'm asking for your last few thoughts as well. We are wrapping up. It's 9 o'clock already. As it stands, Teto says state capture will continue. And I also find it hard to believe that it won't. I can't see enough stop measures being put in place by government.
We should not rely on government. I think we are a very religious society. The majority of us are committed Christians. And we must remember, the Son of God stood against the Pharisees. He broke the corruption in the temple. And it's about time that all of us emulated. It doesn't need many of us to stand up. Like the temple, Masekos, like the Mosilos. Do not a corrupter or corrupted be. Stand up for your integrity and the future of your children and those yet to be born. Because South Africa needs to be redeemed.
And that's literally it. I'm going to leave it at that. My guest, Dr. Saths Cooper, clinical psychologist, my colleague, Teto Mahlakwana, senior politics journalist here at Eyewitness News. And we had Mosilo Mothepu, former CEO of Trillian, joining us a little bit earlier on, speaking about like the corruption, the endemic corruption, the problem with corruption, and what it takes. What do you sacrifice, and how do you navigate and move away from what we are seeing, where power absolutely corrupts? My name is TD, and this was Inside Eyewitness News. 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 This was Inside Eyewitness News.